Where does this leave the conversation around how much infrastructure we actually need? What were you hearing on the sidelines of the Paris summit?
I heard that we are in the era of infrastructure independence. Basically, I think most large nation-state leaders have realized that modern AI models have risen to the level of general-purpose technologies. You know, in the history of humanity, we've had maybe 20, 22 of these, electricity, the printing press. And when that happens, leaders start realizing that that technology becomes critical to national progress. And so that's what I heard from President Macron and Prime Minister Modi. The summit was co-hosted by France and India. And I also heard from J.D. Vance at the summit that the United States believes that now staying at the frontier of AI infrastructure and making sure that open source is competitive, American open source is competitive, allied open source is competitive with the best models coming out of any country, including China.
Well, speaking of China, when we have the biggest players, China and the U.S., with kind of different values competing against each other, you've talked about what you call joint ventures between nations that perhaps don't have the resources on their own to compete in AI. Talk to us about that.
Yeah, so one of the atomic units of AI is the data center, right? Because if you sort of look at the history or the ingredients of how we got the current deep learning wave, there's really three or four of them. There's compute, there's data, there's algorithms, and there's regulation. And so when it comes to compute, the idea is that there are only some regions that have enough compute and access to the power that's cost competitive to stay at the frontier. I call these hypercenters. We clearly have at least two hypercenters now in the world today. We've got America, and we've got China. And I think every other major nation is now hitting a reckoning point where they're trying to figure out, do they build, do they buy, or do they partner? And so I think I'm quite bullish on the U.S. and her allies teaming up across the what we call the infrastructure stack, right? So when you at the lowest level, you've got chips, and then you get into models, and then you've got applications. And I think it's going to be much more likely that countries that aren't hypercenters today pick which hypercenter they matches their value system the most, and then they work on joint ventures across the stack. Because I think it's quite unlikely that people reinvent the chip stack for them. They're much more likely to partner with a country that does match their value system. And I think clearly in France, America, France, and India were teaming up.
You're on Mistral's board. We were hearing from Afrin a little bit ago, CEO of Mistral. And so has France got it right now? Is that going to become a center in some way? They're committing to their own infrastructure build out, or they ultimately have to depend on the US, at least for chips, for example?
So the zeitgeist has definitely changed. I think from the last two summits, you know, the first that was in Seoul and the last one, which was in Bletchley Park in the UK, the overarching theme was one of pessimism. You know, AI is really risky. We've got to think about the downside. And instead, what I heard this time from leaders across the EU, by the way, not just France, was the idea of optimism, that AI actually can unlock massive growth for Europe and for America. And I think that France is in the middle of figuring out how to accelerate its infrastructure. I think they have a huge head start when it comes to nuclear adoption, but when it comes to data center construction, they're clearly behind the United States, and they're happy to accelerate permitting and construction, and at the same time, they're happy to work with American chip companies like NVIDIA to actually rack and stack frontier chips in these data centers. So I think you're going to see, over the long term, Europe start to accelerate, but in the short term, I think they're going to partner with folks like America.
And the administration is cool with that, because you have close proximity to the administration with A16Z, and at the same time, doesn't see relations are at their highest moment right now.
Well, look, the best thing about this administration is they share everything very publicly. I think JD was very clear in his speech in Europe that we're putting America first, and we will partner and help our allies too. And, you know, NATO is a huge priority for America. And so I think we'll just continue seeing more investments in NATO alliances.
Andreessen Horowitz was an early investor in OpenAI, and you're also on the board of Mistral. I'm just curious, what do you make of this feud between Elon Musk and OpenAI? Does it have broader implications for the progress for other players in the space?
Definitely. Ultimately, where the frontier goes has implications for all of us. But I think the important thing to focus on is that, you know, just a year ago, there were lots of folks who were confidently testifying in front of Congress that America was so far ahead of China that China could never catch up. And I think what we're seeing is, one, the gap between open source and closed source has narrowed. That's something those of us in the open source community have been paying attention, have known for a while. But more importantly, that the gap between America And China has narrowed as well. It's and incredibly fast. You know, O1, which is one of the most cutting-edge models from OpenAI, came out on December 5th. And barely a month and a half later is when DeepSeek R1 came out, you know, January 25th. And it's comparable. And so I think the more important dynamic to pay attention to is that that gap has closed, especially between America and any adversarial nations that aren't in our alliances like NATO.
What about Elon Musk's influence in Washington? Do you think that could have broader implications for other AI players in the space?
Absolutely. I think Elon is an important voice, but I think the reality is that we are reaching a state of disequilibrium in AI infrastructure, where a lot of basic assumptions that people had taken for granted are being revisited, like the gap narrowing between open and closed, between America and other countries. And so I think there are a number of voices, especially in the open source community. Obviously, you know, you just played a great clip from Arthur Mensch, who is the CEO of Mistral. I think there are other important voices like Jan Stoica, who's a professor at UC Berkeley, who has been leading an effort called LMSys that works on AI model evaluations. And I think those kinds of voices are also becoming much more important to nation state leaders. So I'm just really glad that at the highest levels, frontier AI and especially open source AI is getting a lot of attention.
Anjaneya, it's getting a lot of politicization as well. And how comfortable or uncomfortable does that make you? Look, I sat down with David Ulovich a couple of weeks ago. We were talking about American dynamism within this new administration. Then, of course, there's a relatively politicized hire, rightly or wrongly, whether it was politicized, of course, Mr. Penny becoming a deal partner. Of course, Mr. Penny, 26-year-old, was well known for having had an incident on a subway here in New York and ultimately led to the death of someone who was homeless. And there was a read on that hire. How are you feeling about the cultural impact and the perspective of the culture at A16Z this has?
Yeah, look, taking a step back, I think one of the things that's always set A16Z apart is just how strongly the firm believes in its values, right? And so in the case of open source AI, for example, I think the firm has taken a very clear position that we believe open source, the history of computing infrastructure has shown that open source is critical to unlocking massive amounts of productivity for humanity and for society. You know, when you look at storage, networking, compute, and so on, I think a lot of the productivity we've seen from software comes from a value system and a philosophy and a belief that democratizing access to the best technology, putting control of that technology in the hands of the biggest companies and organizations is what pushes technology forward. And so, you know, while I'm not an expert on American dynamism, and I'm sure you can get better opinions from my partner David on that, I think the more important thing to notice is that the firm just stands by its values and its philosophies very aggressively.